I guess screen is visible now. So we'll start for the next lecture of Systems in Mechanical Engineering. I am Vishal Bhagwat, Assistant Professor at Mechanical Department, VPGB IIT Baramati. Welcome you in the Mechanical Engineering lecture series. So we have now lecture 5. We started looking at different power plants and systems in mechanical engineering, and we have seen few. So this was the last lecture, power plant, tidal energy and related power plant. So as you know, this is very basic, and I think you are familiar with this concept. When there is a situation of high tide and low tide, what you see at one side of basin, you will see the quite adequate availability of potential energy of water because of this height. Okay, and then you just use certain dams constructions to stop that water, sea water of course, and then it will be flown when there is no water on this side. Okay, so because of the potential difference, water will be flowing from this side to this side, and you get a rotation of turbine here. Okay, there are different sluice walls or sluice gates. This is a different wall to have a discharge of water from this basin to this side. Okay, and sometimes it is on reverse side also, both way. Okay, so this will work for low tide as well as the high tide zone. And today we'll see the next power plant, in fact the next energy that you can get from the hydrogen fuel cell. Okay, so if you are familiar with hydrogen fuel cell, it's very good, but some of you are not familiar with hydrogen fuel cell and how we can get the energy, electrical energy out of it. So we'll see today the hydrogen fuel cell. We'll start with this. So what is the principle here? Basically, the positively charged hydrogen protons and negatively charged electrons split at the anode. Okay, there is always reactions, oxidation reactions at anode and cathode. So you see at anode, the hydrogen protons and the electrons are splitted. The electrons are forced to flow through the circuit, creating the electric current. Okay, so this is the one way. Just a minute, I'll admit people who are waiting now. So please have practice with VPGB IIT domain email ID. So you got the principle, right? The positively charged hydrogen protons and negatively charged electrons splitted at the anode. Okay, and the electrons are forced to flow through the circuit, creating an, of course, electric current. So that is the basic funda of hydrogen fuel cell. Okay, we need to split somehow. So hydrogen gas, if you talk about it, it is quite difficult to store. Okay, but anyhow, it can be stored in metal hydrides like iron, titanium, then magnesium, nickel. And in case of in compressed gas, if you compress it too much, then it can be stored as a compressed gas as well as in liquefied hydrogen. Okay, so these are the different ways to store the hydrogen gas. Understood? So in metal hydrides like iron, titanium, magnesium, nickel, then under compression or under pressure, it can be stored as a compressed gas in the cylinders, or it can be liquefied as a hydrogen only. So that is, but it's a serious problem because it's a highly flammable hydrogen gas. Okay, now if you see the construction of simple the hydrogen fuel cell, you'll see this. Okay, at one side there is anode. Okay, this is anode and this is a cathode, you can see here, and in between there is a electrolyte. Okay, so electrolyte can be acidic solution or maybe it is alkaline solution. And we'll see how it is happening. So electrolyte, if you see, one can have H2SO4 if we say it is a acidic hydrogen fuel cell. Okay, and one can have KOH for alkaline or alkali hydrogen fuel cell. Understood? This is a electrolyte. Okay, I'm talking about electrolyte. And based on that, there will be, of course, same reaction as overall reaction will be same, but there will be some steps between which. And now what about the anode? Okay, so anode is it kind of a catalyst for the reaction. Okay, so platinum is the strongest catalyst in the reaction, platinum. But as it is very costly, one can use nickel, okay, permeable nickel electrodes or silver electrodes, okay, as a anode and cathode in this reaction, hydrogen cell. You need to note down this very carefully so that you will remember. Of course, no need to have nice handwritten notes, but at least note down the points, okay, so that you can remember it well. So, of course, platinum can be used, but it is very costly. So we have options like nickel electrodes or silver electrodes, and those are permeable. Those are porous. Permeable means porous. So here it is an anode, and this side it is a cathode. Okay. And now what happens at the hydrogen? See, now you can see from the construction on the anode side, we are passing the fuel. Okay, that is a hydrogen gas. We are passing the fuel, hydrogen gas. And on the cathode side, we are passing the only oxygen or air on this side. Now, remember, these two electrodes are porous. You can understand porous means what? Okay, porous. That's why I have written here the permeable electrode, nickel electrodes. Now, on anode side, this is the reaction, hydrogen. The hydrogen is split like, you know, there is two H plus ions and plus two electrons. Okay, this way. This is the anode reaction, anodic reaction. And then as air is passed near the in the vicinity of cathode, you will see this is the reaction, half O2 plus H2O plus twice electron, you will get twice OH group, hydroxyl. So this is the cathodic reaction. Now you will have here twice H plus twice OH, those are combining, and you will have then twice H2O. Very commonly. And what you see, the overall reaction is H2 plus half of O2 here, right? H2 plus half of O2, you'll get H2. This is overall reaction. Here, if you observe at anode, electrons are splitted, right? The hydrogen ions are permeable. I mean, there is a permeable nickel electrode. So the hydrogen ions are permitted to pass from this anode and react with this electrolyte, and because of this cathode, now there will be a reaction, this kind of reaction, where you will find the OH formation, OH group formation, and then OH is combining with the H plus ions, you'll get it H2. Electrons, those are separated here, those are intended to flow from this circuit, as anode and cathode, those are connected. Okay, so charge will be from this anode to cathode side, and here you can have the load. Okay, I can say electric load here, so you can glow the bulb simple way, or this charge you can utilize later. Okay, so this is the thing, but separation of the electrons and using it for the electricity generation. That is nothing but the hydrogen fuel cell. I hope you understood it. Well, see the advantage and disadvantage. Very common, like I said, hydrogen is difficult to store, right? So we'll see the first advantages. It is readily available. Okay, we have abundant quantity of hydrogen that is available in water, of course. And that is available in everywhere, and we need to separate it out. Okay, that's the matter. It doesn't produce harmful emission like CO, then the hydrocarbons. Okay, so those kind of emissions are not produced once you burn the hydrogen fuel cell or when you use it. No need to burn here, but when you use it. Okay, so that does not create any emission. It can be used as a fuel in rockets. It is fuel efficient. Of course, you get better efficiency for product in order to produce the electricity out of this compared to other fuels. It is renewable. Okay, it is renewable. It is available in nature. So one can say it is actually renewable source of energy. Okay, renewable source of energy. Disadvantages. You see, disadvantages. One can tell me what may be the disadvantages then, other than storage problem.
H2 gas is costly.
H2 gas may be costly. Okay. What else? Correct. That is fine. H2 gas is costly. What else?
Setting up the plant is costly.
Setting up the plant, instead of that, what you can say, what you get energy here, it is in less quantity. So in less extent. So in you need to go for the series and parallel connections in order to have adequate amount of electricity generation for particular application. Okay. So this is the few only disadvantages associated with it. So of course, difficult to store, right? Then it is highly flammable. And of course, you need to go for the series connection, series and parallel connection. That is one more disadvantage, in fact. If you understood, we'll go for the next power plant, that is geothermal power plant. And I hope you have seen the YouTube video posted earlier on your WhatsApp group about the geothermal power plant. But those students have not seen it. I'll repeat for them, but it will be short. Okay. So try to have what you need to concentrate here when I'm covering some syllabus, theoretical syllabus or numerical syllabus. What is important? So those things you need to note down. For example, figure is important. Okay. Then, for example, applications are important. Okay, or some simple principle is important. So you note down in simple words, your words. Now I say geothermal power plant. As you say, mention the word geothermal. Of course, it is related to earth and earth crust, and what you get from the earth crust reservoir, that thermal energy, that is nothing but a geothermal energy. So thermal energy from the earth crust is utilized for electricity generation. That is the principle, simple principle for the geothermal power plant. And it is known for many years that a core of Earth is considerably hot, and it has also been found that Earth contains large reservoir of steam. Okay, because in the Earth crust there is a huge amount of heat source. It is very hot because of lava and all. So nearby that there may be water storage, and it will be continuously heated. So you get a continuous heat formation. And once it is channelized through boreholes and all, you can get the steam. Okay. Of course, at different level from the earth surface, there is a different temperature of steam. Okay. So it will vary from 30 meters, okay, 300 meters to 6 kilometers. That is the range. You can imagine 600 meters to 6 kilometer. That is the range. And up to 6 kilometer, you can get the steam of high temperature. So this naturally available steam can be directly used for steam power plant. And steam power plant, when you say, basically there is a steam turbine, and we rotate the steam turbine in order to generate the electricity through the generators. That is the simple concept. Now when you see, basically the energy is extracted by three different methods for the geothermal power plant. This is the oldest one. Dry steam power plant. Okay, the first dry steam power plant was installed in 1904. Okay, 1904, and what it is the oldest one. Now people are not using this. In fact, in order to use the geothermal power plant, we need to have certain potential sites only. And India is not having any geothermal power plant right now, but we have identified some of the potential sites where the geothermal power plant can be constructed. Understood. So geothermal power plant, temperature is more than 235 degrees Celsius. Okay. I'll tell you what is it, dry steam power plant. Okay. Then you just remember this name, dry steam power plant, where from the earth crust you can use direct steam. Okay, the very high temperature steam, it will be directly blown over the turbine. Okay, now flash steam power plant, it will run more than 180 degrees Celsius. Okay, more than 180 degrees Celsius you get a steam here, and it's called as a flash steam power plant because there is a flash chamber. The steam or the hot brine, I say brine only, you cannot say cold brine or hot brine, just say brine. Okay, brine, some salty solutions, a mixture of water and steam. Okay, salty, that is collected from the earth crust, and it is separated in the flash chamber. Once it is received, it is collected at the flash chamber, and here it is separated. It is separated into the required temperature steam and waste. So required temperature steam only it is blown over the turbine, and remaining amount that is, let's say you say waste or the salty water, it will be separated out and it will be sent back to the earth crust. So that is the flash steam power plant. Understood? So why flash steam power plant is named? Because there is a flash chamber where you are separating actually the only steam and then the remaining salty water or the remaining material. And for syllabus point of view, the third one is the binary cycle power plant. This you need to look at very carefully. And what is binary cycle power plant? Because as name suggested here, binary means there is another fluid. There is another fluid which will be heated, that will be converted to steam, and that is blown over the turbine. So it's binary. And what about the primary one? So primary is nothing but steam as usual. So that steam or the brine, hot brine, you are collecting from the reservoir, earth crust, and in some heat exchanger, there will be heat exchange with the binary fluid, and that binary fluid will be heated, and it will be converted to steam. Steam will be blown over the turbine. Turbine is running with the generator, and you produce the electricity. All are same. Okay, all are the same. And what is the importance of this temperature is it will run less than 220 degrees Celsius. You can imagine. And as temperature is less, okay, temperature is less, of course you require some other fluid to convert into steam, and that steam should have high temperature and pressure, of course. So that is nothing, that is called as a binary cycle. Okay, temperature is less, that's why you are using that heat only to boil or convert it into steam. That's such a fluid which will have less boiling temperature. And those are nothing but isobutane, isopentane. Okay, these are the certain fluids. Here is the schematic representation of binary cycle geothermal power plant. Okay, so I hope now you can understand this portion of the figure, why it's important, because it is same from the turbine. It is same. You will have everywhere, you will have the turbine, then generator, and then you will cool the steam which is passing out from the turbine. It is cooled or condensed in the condenser. That condensate again, it will be sent to the heat exchanger. So same way. Now we will explain what is it. This is the ground level, and almost up to 3 kilometer, up to 6 kilometer from that zone, you are extracting the hot steam or the hot the brine. Okay, the brine. So that hot fluid that you are extracting, the water sometimes are received, and it is exchanging heat in the heat exchanger. Heat exchanger, it is some kind of a chamber where the heat is exchange to the fluid passing from the heat exchanger. And what is that fluid? Is the isobutane or isopentane, where those fluids, of course, those are having less boiling point temperature. So as it is exchanged, the heat is exchanged, suddenly those starting that fluid is starting boiling, and it is converted into high pressure, high temperature steam. That steam from the isobutane and pentane, it will be blown over the turbine, and with that high pressure, high temperature steam, turbines are rotated. Rotations are mechanical rotations are given to the generator. Generator produces electricity. After expansion of steam, pressure energy is utilized to the turbine rotations, and low pressure steam is passed to the condenser. In the condenser, it is supplied, and you will see in the condenser what is there. There are the tubes, and from the tube water is recirculated. This is a cool water which is at almost 25 or 23 degrees Celsius. So that cool water is recirculated through the condenser tubes. Around condenser tubes there will be steam. So steam, as it is in contact with these tubes, it is getting condensed, and it is getting converted into a liquid, and that liquid is again extracted with the help of condensate extracting pump back to the heat exchanger. Back to the heat exchanger, it will be pumped back. So the condenser output, we always say as a condensate. Okay, it is a condensate. don't say it is water or other liquid, or don't name it, just say the output of condenser is condensate. So condensate is pumped back to the heat exchanger. That way you say all this. Then about here, once the steam is exchanging heat to the isobutane liquid here in the heat exchanger, the steam is it is supplied back to the rejection well here. So this is a production well from where you are getting the hot material, hot water, hot steam. And here it is the rejection well where you are dumping it down almost at 1 kilometer or 2 kilometer down with the pressure. So this is nothing but the rejection well. So this is about the binary cycle geothermal power plant. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Kaina, if you have any doubt, rule number one, Kaina Sheikh.
No, sir.
Okay, fine. We'll cover it then. Is there any doubt, Akshata?
Sir, can we explain again?
Okay, I'll explain again. From this figure, is it okay? From this figure?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what we are talking about, the binary cycle geothermal power plant, as name suggested, geothermal means whatever you are getting from the beneath the earth level, from that reservoir, whatever energy you get, that is called geothermal. Okay. So, there are already hot reservoirs under the ground level. So, we are identifying them. And then we are making certain boreholes. Okay. So from boreholes, now you are able to extract the heat in the form of hot steam or hot brine. Why I'm talking about brine? Because I cannot say water, because not necessarily it is water. It will be water, then some the salt solutions. That's why I'm talking about the brine. So brine or the steam, it is extracted from the production well and it is sent to the heat exchanger. What is happening in the heat exchanger? Already isobutane or isopentane like fluid is passing here. So that is in liquid form. When it is in heat exchanger, the heat, hot steam, it is exchanging heat with that fluid and it is heated. It starts boiling because its temperature is low. Whose isobutane or isopentane? So it is converted into steam and then it is the high pressure, high temperature steam is blown over the turbine. This is a schematic representation of turbine. This side is this is trapezoidal. This side is the narrow one. This is the large one. Okay. So once turbine is rotated because of high pressure, high temperature steam, generator is producing electricity as it is coupled, as it is coupled, it is connected. Then pressure energy is utilized for rotation of turbine. And low pressure steam, but high temperature, low pressure, high temperature steam is collected inside the condenser. What is happening in the condenser? Already there are some tubes from which cold water of near about 23 or 25 degrees Celsius temperature, it is flowing. As it is in contact, not the water, okay, tube, water tubes. As it is in vicinity of steam, steam is getting condensed and it is collected here. So that condensate, the collected steam, the liquid, the condensate, it is extracted back to the heat exchanger and it is in cyclic process. It is in cyclic. You can see there is no way out. It is in cyclic process. So efficiency is quite high. You can use that isobutane or isopentane again and again. What is happening? Only form is changing. Before coming to heat exchanger, it is in liquid state. After it output is in steam. Okay. In the condenser, when it is coming, it is in steam. When it is coming out, it is in liquid. So only form is changing. And you know, when form is changing, some amount of energy is utilized. Okay, you can use this energy. In the cooling tower, what is happening? Cool water is recirculating. Cool water is giving its heat. Its temperature is low. When we can say it is giving heat. So cool water, when it is cooling the steam, it is getting heated. Now cool water at 25 degrees Celsius, which is coming inside the condenser, when it is coming out, it may be at 45 or 50 degrees Celsius. So that hot water now, it is sprinkled down from the cooling tower. Now this cooling tower, what you see, it is not this small. It is very big actually. And it is quite away from this this plant. Okay, little bit away. So this is very big, of course. And then the hot water, which is pumped at the top of the cooling tower. It is sprinkled from that side, and when it is coming down, it is getting cooled because of the gravity. Okay, because of the gravity, so it is cooling down, and the cool water is again collected, and it is recirculated back with the water recirculator. Now I hope you have understood it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now we will see the disadvantage quickly. It is a reliable source of energy. Okay, reliable source because it is available beneath the earth. Okay, reliable one. No harmful emission, of course. No hydrocarbons, no CO, such kind of emissions. It is having high efficiency because you have seen it is in cyclic process. Isobutane is running in a cyclic process. Low maintenance required. Once it is installed, you can run unless there is leakage. Okay, unless there is no leakage, of course you can use it. You can run the power plant. No external source required to keep power plant in running mode. Okay, and power stations are smaller in size. So the energy that you can get is almost 500 kilowatt. Okay, to few megawatts only. Disadvantages associated with it, that is possibility of depletion of geothermal sources, because those are the reservoirs and those are depleting. Once you start extracting energy out of it, those will be vanishing soon. So there is a chances to deplete these sources. High investment cost because you need to find such locations, you need to install equipments there, the big machineries and all, construct the power plants. So initial cost is high one. Initial cost is high. And of course, the transportation for installation of this, whatever required material will be required for transportation, installation, transportation cost is high. Okay, because those locations are very rare. Source is close to volcanic activity. And volcanic activities are very dynamic one. Okay, very dynamic. Soon there may not be any volcanic activity once you start extracting energy out of it. So those may stop working suddenly, this kind of power plant. So whatever investment you have made, it may be dangerous. That will be waste of money sometimes. So it is a little bit difficult to use it continuously. So that is disadvantage. In case of potential sites, if you look at in India, you will see in Puga Valley in Jammu and Kashmir, then in Chhattisgarh, okay, in Godavari Basin, Manikarnar, so Himachal Pradesh, that is the area where you can find such locations. Then please start entering your roll numbers as the attendance. You start entering your roll numbers in chat box. Now you can see another site that is in Tuva, Gujarat, West Bengal, that is Bakreshwar. Then in Maharashtra, Unai, in Jalgaon, another location in Maharashtra, where you can get these potential sites. Remember, we are not running any geothermal right now, but we have these potential sites. Now biomass, very easy and very familiar to you. But as it is in part in syllabus, we'll talk about it a little bit. Can you tell me what is biomass? So biomass is actually, it is about terrestrial and aquatic organic matter produced by plant and animal byproducts. That is the biomass. Biomass is actually the plant, those are in water, those are on land. So organic matter produced out of it, and animal byproducts, that is together, is called as a biomass. And now can you tell me the applications of biomass? Applications of biomass? Swapnil Thombre, roll number 42. Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Tell me, what do you know about biomass, bioenergy? Some of the examples.
Biogas is used in cooking, sir.
Biogas is used in cooking. That's fine. What else?
Else,
You know, methanol, ethanol, ethanol, almost 10% ethanol. You can unmute mute yourself now. So then you can mute yourself. So you know, ethanol that can be embedded in the diesel. Okay, and then we can use as a that material as a, I mean that combination as a biodiesel. Methanol, ethanol, it can be mixed with the petrol, diesel, or some other petroleum oils. Okay. Where it can be a good blend, and of course you can control the pollution. Okay, so this is a thing about the some important thing about the biomass. So biodiesel is one. So I can say resources, biomass from the agriculture field, okay, cultivated fields where there are some living organisms, these earthworms and all. So those can make the agriculture field that can convert into biomass. Okay, it will have maximum content of biomass. Biomass derived from the waste. Okay, so animal waste and all. Okay, human extracts and those things. So that is the biomass extract derived from the waste. The factory waste, industry waste and all those things. Biomass conversion into liquid fuels like methanol, ethanol. Okay, that is one thing. Now, ways of energy extraction from the biomass. There are a few ways. One is these thermochemical conversion. Thermochemical conversion. So one is by this one, the gasification, and another is this pyrolysis. Gasification and pyrolysis. You see, what is happening in do you have any idea? Nirmala Sherki, can tell me, are you there? Rule number 5. Nirmala Sherki. See, I'll be calling such numbers and I'll be checking whether you are attending a lecture or not. Okay. So it's okay. Just stop, quiet. It doesn't matter if you keep your roll number in chat box multiple times, but I'll be asking you question, and if you don't reply me, then your attendance will not be marked. Okay, so that is very simple rule. Okay, so tell me, Nirmala, do you have any idea about thermochemical conversion, gasification and pyrolysis?
Kaisa
hoga?
Yes, sir.
You can ask me. Thermochemical conversion, gasification and pyrolysis, these reactions or these methods, what is exactly happening here? I guess these things you might have learned in chemistry earlier in 10th standard, 11th standard, or maybe 12th standard, or earlier to it.
Biomass produced from synthesis gas. Hello?
Yes. Now, you can mute yourself now. Thermochemical conversion, what happens here, actually, the heating of biomass, actually, in absence of oxygen and air. Gasification, where only limited amount of oxygen and air is present when you are heating the biomass. These are the, I'm talking about the ways of energy extraction from the biomass. You have now biomass resources are given here in earlier sentences. Now, once you have the biomass, how do you extract the energy out of it? So these are the some techniques. One is thermochemical conversion. First one is gasification. In case of gasification, biomass is heated in limited amount of oxygen or the air, and then it will produce certain gases like hydrogen, then the methane, nitrogen, CO. Okay, that may have low calorific value. Calorific value you will see now next. So that is nothing but gasification. In case of pyrolysis, you will heat the biomass in closed cylinder. Almost absence of oxygen and air. You just burn it in closed cylinder. That is nothing but pyrolysis, where you can get certain byproducts. I mean, the products or the fuel in terms of solid, liquid, and gases. certain organic materials like rubber and plastic also converted into fuel. Okay, from plastic, you might have heard people are using fuel from plastic. So plastic is organic material anyway, rubber, plastic, that can be pyrolyzed. I mean, pyrolysis is done on it and then you can generate the fuel. So that can be used for your particular application. So that is a thermochemical conversion. Now, biochemical conversion, and this is very famous, very well known. Biochemical means there is a fermentation and anaerobic fermentation or digestion. So there may be some microorganisms, and then microorganisms are actually fermenting a bacteria or yeast, those are enzymes that will be actually will be in reaction, and that that is active as a fermentation reaction. Okay, so that is about the biochemical conversion. And third one can be just combustion. Okay, just burn it. Okay, just burn it and get the energy out of it. Okay, so that is nothing but a biomass. So from cow dung, people are using certain, you know, the pieces, chop pieces, and those are burning. Okay, so that is nothing but the biomass burning condition. So third one is biomass burning or combustion. So biomass energy applications can be gas for cooking, then running the engine. You can use the you can run the engine. Okay, the pumping water applications, then electricity generation, of course, that is the main interest of area for us. Then biofuel like biodiesel, ethanol, that is blended. Vegetable oils, you know, the vegetable oils. Okay, some of the vegetable oils are also can be used, and vegetable oils like, you know, sunflower oil and all, jatropha oil. So those vegetable oils are the product of bio energy, biomass, and blending. And there are some blending applications. So certain oils you are blending in different applications or the different products. So that was about the power plants. And the next section, actually, we are starting for the power producing devices. Just note down these things, power producing devices. What you can see here about power producing devices, you have boilers, then you have IC engine, internal combustion engine, you have turbines. So if you remember what we have covered out of this in practical session, do you remember what we have covered?
Internal combustion engine.
It is about internal combustion engine, right? We have covered internal combustion engine and both the types, in fact, the spark ignition and compression ignition engine. Those who are absent, they can watch the video, YouTube video available, or I'll post in today or tonight. Okay, tomorrow I can post. So that video you can check, learn it well, and you can solve the concept test. Okay, today I'll be posting few concept tests. The turbine we'll see soon. About the boiler, this is the boiler. We just have a note. This is a boiler. You'll see this is a water tube boiler. If you observe, I will close in couple of minutes. You can start entering your roll numbers again. So this is nothing but a shell, a boiler shell where water is heated. Okay, water is heated. You can just check the cursor. Okay, water is heated here. And what is this is the tube. It's a connection from which water is circulating. So water is coming down here and it is getting heated and it is going up. So there is a furnace here. So furnace, as you burn the coal or the oil, diesel or petrol, anything, kerosene. So flue gases are generating. So that heat will be passed over these water tubes. This is not a single water tube. There are many water tubes here. So from the water tube, water is recirculating. It is heated. Why this angle is given? Because the dense water will be heated. As it is getting heated, it will be losing its density and it will be rising here. So hot water is passed here and the hot water is soon converted into steam. And then steam is passed from this end. The required amount of pressurized heat, steam, it is passed from this walls. So this is nothing but a water tube boiler. Very simple concept. Why it is called water tube boiler? Because from the tube there will be water. So water inside the tube, it is heated and converted to steam. That's why it is called water tube boiler. And on other side, it is fire tube boiler. Why? Because fire or the flue gases are passed from the tubes. And those are hitting the water in the vicinity, nearby water in the tank. So there is a tank, the boiler, inside that there is a tank of water. And in the tank of water, there are tubes. So from the tube, what is passed? The hot flue gases, very high temperature, hot, red hot, very black, hot gases are passed. And those are hitting the water in the tank. And then the water is converted to steam and it will be collected at the steam out here. At the steam vents. So the flue gases are passed from the chimney here. Okay, there is a chimney. You might have seen the chimneys to industries, and from that you can pass the hot gases. So this is a fire tube boiler. Why? Because flue gases or hot gases are passed from the tubes. This is water tube boiler. Why? Because water is passed from the tube and it is heated. So simple. This is about the water tube and fire tube boiler. So we'll see the difference of between the fire tube and water tube boiler in the next lecture. Okay, this is the figure that you need to represent in exam, and you just note down this example. Okay, time to have the example. Please note down quickly, all of you. Please note down quickly this example. I'll read for you. Coal consumption of thermal power plant is 100 tons of anthracite coal per day. Are you there? Are you writing?
Yes, sir.
Okay, please write down quickly. Coal consumption of thermal power plant is 100 tons. Now you must know what is 1 ton. Okay, 1 ton is 1,000 kg. Okay, 1,000 kg. So that means, yes, that way you have to convert it. So 100 tons, 100,000 kg of anthracite coal per day. Anthracite is it's a quality of coal. Okay, per day. Calorific value of coal is 5,800 kg, kilojoule per kg. Okay, kilojoule per kg. If power generation for in one day is 500 kilowatt, find the overall efficiency of power plant. Find the efficiency of power plant. Now, any idea to solve it quickly? We will have only two more minutes. We'll stop now. Please try to enter your roll numbers. You can post your answer in chat box. Any idea how to solve? Come on, 58 students are present. Okay, fine. Any idea how to start? Is there any preliminary? Okay, fine. So if you want to solve it, what is asked, you need to find check. What is asked? It is the overall efficiency of power plant. So our efficiency of power plant is always output upon input. So that way you can note down somewhere. Okay, you can note down it somewhere. That is, you can solve it yourself. So output upon input, and input is 100,000 kg. Coal with calorific value 5,800 kilojoule per kg. You have to answer me later. You can mail me this screenshot or your answer. Chalo. So calorific value, what is the relation? How to get the input energy or input power from the calorific value and weight of the coal? That you can check, search, and then you will have ratio of output upon input. That will be the efficiency. Fine. So we'll stop here. Now you can leave meeting.